الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد All praise is due to Allah and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم As to what follows, quoting Jesus Why would I quote Jesus? What is the benefit behind quoting Jesus? I'm quoting Jesus because Jesus deserves to be quoted. I'm quoting Jesus because Jesus is probably the most controversial figure in the world. I'm quoting Jesus because when Jesus is quoted, we get to learn about his message as opposed to what people said about him. I'm quoting Jesus because when quoting him, my wife became a Muslim. And we hope that by quoting Jesus, my in-laws, her parents, siblings, and the rest of the family will also become Muslims. We quote in Jesus because every Christian in the world should know the truth about Jesus. We quote in Jesus because we love him. We love him. Something that many people don't know. Something that many people have a misconception about. But the truth is, we do. And consequently, we are quoting Jesus. We're quoting Jesus because the matter is paradise and hell. People think this is a trivial issue. Whatever you like. If you like it, you can accept it. If you don't like it, you can refuse it. Religion is a matter of choice. Everybody's religion is correct. A Hindu will go to paradise, and a Buddhist will go to paradise, and a Christian will go to paradise. And even, you know, at some point they will say an atheist will go to paradise, even though an atheist doesn't believe in paradise. Everyone says that this is the way. It's a very confusing matter. Really. And the issue is, most human beings have been overwhelmed with worldly matters, so much so that there is no time to think about paradise and hell, even though paradise and hell are the most serious thing you will ever think about. I mean, just take 5 seconds. Eternal bliss, eternal happiness, eternal contentment, satisfaction, versus eternal hell, eternal pain, eternal torment, eternal punishment. There's nothing greater than that. Nothing more important than that. Nothing more serious than that. And nothing more sensitive than that. But when we quote Jesus, we have an obstacle. A huge obstacle. This obstacle remains to be the main barrier between people and the truth. What is it? Emotionalism. People get emotional. It is a human characteristic, which we don't deny. As a Muslim, I am emotional to Islam. I have an emotional attachment to Islam. And I'm sure that a Christian will feel the same about Christianity, and a Jew will feel the same about Judaism, and Buddhists about Buddhism, and so on and so forth. But when does that become an issue? When the emotionalism becomes a barrier between us and the truth. When the emotional attachment is not based on sound understanding and intellect, rather it is based on feelings only. However, human beings have been given the one distinct quality. The one distinct quality is that we are supposed to use our intellect to evaluate before we use our emotions. All the rest of the creation will use emotionalism before intellect. Except a human being, he is supposed to give precedence to the intellect before he develops an emotional attachment to the truth which he discovers. Because of all these realities and facts and issues and obstacles, quoting Jesus becomes fundamental. Because it's amazing. It is amazing how clear his statements were how consistent they are with the Islamic teachings and how different they are from what everyone else seems to say about him. And this is to defend him. Today, tonight, we are aiming at defending one of the messengers of Allah, because he has been accused of things which he never said and never did. He has been believed, people have believed about him things which he would never approve, nor would he entertain. And it is our job as followers of the prophets and the messengers to defend their honor and to make the truth clear to the people. So this is a plea to every Christian in the world. We are not here to attack. We are not here to put you down. We are not here to make you feel bad. None of the above. This is a plea to think and reflect. Evaluate, then make judgment. At least hear the truth. You owe it to yourself to hear the truth. Then you can make a decision. An intellectual person, a confident person, is always willing to hear the other side. Has no problem, because his intellect and his confidence will allow him to remain upon the truth which he was upon if he is presented with falsehood. And that same kind of individual will be willing to make the changes once he sees the truth, which is something that many people wind up doing. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide everyone to the truth which is pleasing to him. Original sin, these are the main beliefs in Christianity. Original sin, atonement, redemption by crucifixion, divinity of Jesus, and Trinity. This is what Christianity is built upon, irrespective of the denomination. They agree to these factors to some extent. There may be some variations, but that doesn't affect the general picture of Christianity. And we will be dealing with them one by one. The approach will be the following. First, what is being taught today in the name of Christianity. Second, the biblical answer to that. You will find that the Bible is in opposition with what will be said. Then the Islamic answer, which is consistent and harmonious with the biblical one. Then I will bring to you a logical argument which Allah had allowed me to develop in my own mind. Nothing that I got from outside. My own arguments on the logic behind why the biblical and the Quranic teachings are consistent with logic and intellect, and they do not oppose it in any way, shape, or form. Beginning with original sin, according to the most common teaching of Christians, all people inherit Adamic guilt, that's from the word Adam, and are in a state of sin from the moment of conception. And are in the state of sin from the moment of conception. Now we have some comments to make on this one. First, let us deal with the biblical evidences that further elaborate on this point. Is this biblically supported? Now pay attention. What I'm presenting to you is what is taught in Christianity, not necessarily what the Bible teaches. And there's a huge distinction between both. According to the Bible, it says, the soul who sins shall die. The son shall not bear the guilt of the father, nor the father bear the guilt of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon himself. Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 20. Pay attention now. Original sin says, Adam and Eve disobeyed Allah. They became sinful. There was no forgiveness granted to them. They didn't repent, or Allah didn't accept their repentance. So they had this original sin which we were born with because we inherited that sin. Okay, but the Bible says that the son does not bear the guilt of the father. You can't bear the sin of Adam, alayhi salatu salam, nor can, you know, the father bear the guilt of the son. If you commit a crime, no one can take your father to court and punish him. The righteousness for the righteous and the wickedness is upon the wicked. That's one point. The Islamic evidence is, as usual, consistent with the biblical ones. Allah says, لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَعَلَيْهَا مَا اكْتَسَبَتْ. Allah does not charge a soul except with that within its capacity. It will have the consequence of what good it has gained And it will bear the consequence of what evil it has earned. Everyone is responsible for his or herself. Another ayah which supports this is the one where Allah says, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى وَأَنْ تَدْعُ مُثْقَلَةٌ إِلَى حِمْلِهَا لَا يُحْمَلْ مِنْهُ شَيْءٌ وَلَوْ كَانَ ذَا قُرْبَى. Subhanallah. And no bearer of burdens will bear the burden of another. Then it continues, and if a heavily laden soul calls another to carry some of its load, nothing of it will be carried, even if he should be a close relative. Even if it's your brother, say, can you take some sins on me on the day of judgment? He will be unable to help you. Everyone is responsible for himself or herself. This is the biblical teaching, the Islamic teaching. Okay, what about logic? Logical evidence. Can you imagine? Now, I'm assuming that all of your fathers are nice people. But assume someone's father committed a crime and then he passed away. You were born, and when you were born, the country in which you live in made you carry the criminal record of your father. And as soon as you became of age, he said, okay, it's time to go to jail. Why? Well, your father committed a crime, okay? And come on, let's go to jail. Hello? What did I do? I wasn't there. He didn't ask me. I didn't help. I wasn't even born. Now, do you know any country in the world where this law would apply? No. And if this law applied, don't you think there'll be riots and protests and the people will never accept this? Say, what is this? That's the reality. Logically, you can't bury the criminal, you can't inherit the criminal record of someone else. And Adam and Eve disobeyed Allah, they turned in repentance to Allah, and it was over right then and there. And even if Allah didn't forgive them, which Allah did, you still cannot possibly inherit the sin. Not biblically, not Islamically, and not logically. Doesn't that make sense? It makes sense to me and I love it. Next, atonement. By the way, you want to hear something interesting? The word atonement was only invented in the 16th century. And it's a combination of the word at-one-ment. One-ment having to do with the oneness of God. At meaning reconciling with God. They had to come up with this term for the Christian world in order to bring the idea of one's sins being forgiven through accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior, as we will see in redemption. So this is actually an invented English term which didn't exist in the ancient English language. This is quite relatively new. Now, what do we know about atonement? It's a doctrine that describes how sin can be forgiven by God. How are sins forgiven? It is very important to know, because each one of us here is sinful in his own way, in his or her own way. How do we get rid of these sins? What is the manner? What is the method? What is the way? Now, biblical evidences teach us the following. One of the means for your sins to be forgiven is what? Repentance. In Arabic, tawbah. And we will see it some more. It says in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, from the time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus answered and said to them, do you suppose that these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans because they suffered such things? I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Tawbah is conditional for you to avoid destruction. Something that Jesus was also teaching. So it's the very consistent teachings. Now, it says here, but if a wicked man, this is by the way, earlier I quoted Ezekiel about, the father shall not bear the sin of the son and vice versa. Now this is a continuation. It gives you the solution. But if a wicked man turns from all his sins which he has committed, keeps all his statutes, and does what is lawful and right, he shall surely live, he shall not die. If you change your ways, and we will see the Islamic consistency with this particular teaching from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unbelievable. Therefore, I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, so that iniquity will not be your ruin. Islamic evidence. Repentance is one of the ways for you to have atonement. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ Then Adam received from his Lord some words, and he accepted his repentance. Indeed, it is he who accepts repentance, the merciful. Allah Azza wa Jal accepted the repentance of Adam right then and there. Atonement was accomplished while Adam was still in the early stages of his creation. From the time he made the sin, he turned in repentance to Allah, then everything happened afterwards. Allah forgave him way back, subhanAllah, because Allah is Al-Ghafoor Al-Rahim. And another ayah Allah says in a hadith Qudsi. A hadith Qudsi is where the Prophet ﷺ narrates the hadith and he narrates it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in a hadith Qudsi, O son of Adam, so long as you call upon me and ask of me, I shall forgive you what you have done and I shall not mind. It continues, O son of Adam, were you sins to reach the clouds of the sky? And were you then to ask forgiveness of me, I would forgive you. O son of Adam, were you to come to me with sins nearly as great as the earth? And were you then to face me, ascribing no partner to me, I would bring your forgiveness nearly as great as it. If you come without shirk, without worshipping others with Allah, whether it is Mary or Jesus or the Holy Spirit or any of the saints or any other creature, if you don't ascribe partners with Allah and you come to Allah with Tawheed, then if Allah wills, He will forgive all of the sins. This is the biblical and Islamic. Another means of sins being expiated is through calamities. Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ And we will surely test you with something of fear and hunger and a loss of wealth and lives and fruits, but give good tidings to the patient. Good news for the patient who suffer these calamities, because the Prophet ﷺ will explain to us what happens. He says, trials will continue to befall the believing man or woman in himself, his child and his wealth, until he meets Allah with no sin on him. So these sins will be means, these calamities, excuse me, will be means for the sins to be forgiven. The third way for your sins to be forgiven is the good deeds erase the bad deeds. Allah says, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا Except for those who repent, believe and do righteous work. For them Allah will replace their evil deeds with good. And ever is Allah forgiving and merciful. In another ayah Allah says, إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ Verily, the good deeds remove the evil deeds. So far, how do you get atonement? First, by repenting to Allah. Second, when you suffer calamities, sins are forgiven. Thirdly, when you do good deeds, they erase the bad deeds. And lastly, the oneness of Allah. If Allah wills, He will forgive you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ وَمَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا Allah, indeed Allah does not forgive association with Him, but He forgives what is less than that for whom He wills. And he who associates others with Allah has certainly gone far astray. And we know in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, a man will come with many evil deeds and a card which has La ilaha illallah with the good deeds which he had done. And Allah Azza wa Jal, if He wills, will forgive this particular individual. It doesn't mean as Muslims we depend on that. We still have to strive. But the Mashi'ah, this is the will of Allah. If you meet Him while being a Muslim, then Allah does what He wills. However, we don't take any chances. We want to guarantee paradise. We don't want to take any chances. Logical evidence. This is the nice office of... Sometimes I wish I had this one. For the CEO. Okay, there's a CEO who works there. You are the employee. Now, for whatever reason, this guy loves you. The CEO of the whole company loves you. And he tells you, Muhammad, anything you need, you come to me. You want vacation? You come to me. You want a bonus? You come to me. You want to be promoted? Anything you want, please, My office is ready and welcoming you anytime you come. But don't go through anyone else. I don't want you to go through some manager who will come and tell me that you have made such a request. I don't like that. You have anything, you come to me directly. Does that sound good? Sounds beautiful. However, this employee who has a direct line, after being told all this, he decides that he wants to take a day off. Is the day off a big deal? For a CEO who loves him so much, he told him, I'll give you more money, I'll give you bonus, I'll give you promotion. Do you think his boss, his CEO, would refuse to give him a day off? Not at all. So this guy, what does he do? He goes to the manager. Listen, can you please speak to the CEO and tell him that I want to go, you know, take Wednesday off? So the manager says, sure, no problem. He doesn't know what's going on. He goes to the, you know, the CEO. He says, oh, by the way, Muhammad says that he wants to go, you know, he wants to take a day off. What do you think will be the reaction of the CEO? If I were him, I would fire him. Alatul, say, okay, you know what? While you're going to Muhammad, give him this paper right here. Ma'a salama. I don't want this kind of individual. I don't want someone that, you know, thick-minded, as they say. Come on, man. I'm giving you all the privileges in the world. You don't want it. Now, why am I using this example? Allah Azza wa Jal had given us a direct line. If you disobey, if you fall into sin, if you go astray, then Allah told you, go back to me. Refer to me. Call on me. Ud'uni astajib lakum. Call on me, I will respond to you. And people insist on going through intermediaries. They insist on finding someone in between to go speak to God on their behalf. I'm too bad, so this saint must be better than me. Please tell Allah to forgive me. But Allah told you, you can go direct. The same way that if you were a boss, a CEO, you would fire that employee, Allah Azza wa Jal will put these people in a place where they will not be entertained. Because He had given them everything they need to go directly to Him, and they insisted on finding intermediaries between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a dangerous, dangerous move. Redemption by crucifixion. Maybe you've heard these words before. What does that mean? It's the belief that the death of the Son of God on the cross atoned for the original sin that man inherited from Adam, and that salvation may be attained by believing in Jesus as the Lord and Savior. Very, very important. The conception that is available among the Christians, that for you to become one with God, for you to receive salvation, you must accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Without that, you will not get it. And He has to be crucified. You must believe that He was crucified, He was buried, and He was resurrected, you know, 3 days later. And with that complete belief system, then and only then, you will have salvation. If you don't accept that, no salvation for you. Okay, let's see. What does the Bible say? Fathers shall not be put to death for their children, nor shall the children be put to death for their fathers. A person shall be put to death for his own sin. Jesus, peace be upon him, a righteous man, special creation of Allah, no father interference, okay? He gave sight to the blind by the will of Allah. He healed the leper by the will of Allah. He gave life to the dead by the will of Allah. In fact, another Islamic, you know, miracle which we believe in Islam and the Quran, He spoke at birth. He spoke as a baby in the cradle to defend His mother, which is not, you know, found among Christianity. Why would He have to pay for everyone else's when the Bible clearly teaches that the father and the son, whoever makes a mistake, no one will be held responsible for the others? This is very important. Islamic evidence is clear. وقولهم إن قتلنا المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله وما قتلوه وما صلبوه ولكن شبه لهم وإن الذين اختلفوا فيه لفي شك منه ما لهم به من علم إلا اتباع الظن وما قتلوه يقينا. And for their saying, the Jews, indeed we have killed the Messiah, Jesus the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah, and they did not kill him, nor did they crucify him. But it was made to appear like that to them. It was made to appear like that to them. What exactly happened is from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was made to appear. Some explanations that, you know, a person was made to resemble him, and other explanations may say otherwise. The fact that we don't have any solid evidence makes us as Muslims hold back on elaborating on matters that we don't have evidences for. But the bottom line is, it was made to appear like that to them. They didn't crucify him, they didn't kill him. And if you listen to Bart Ehrman, he was an ex-Christian who's an agnostic now. He holds debates with Christians proving that the crucifixion did not take place historically. This is his argument, just as Allah said. Look what Allah said about it in the next ayah. And indeed those who differ over it are in doubt about it. They have no knowledge of it except the following of assumption, and they did not kill him for certain. So can you imagine a person who studied the Greek language so that he may study the whole Bible in the original manuscripts? The Bible was first written in Greek. He studied the Greek language. He is the most, you know, qualified biblical scholar. He is standing on the same platform with another Christian trying to prove to him that crucifixion didn't take place. This is a manifestation of Allah's statement that they are in doubt. They have no certain knowledge. How can it be? If it was so certain, there would be no dispute about it. There would be absolutely no dispute about it. Subhanallah al-Azim. Allah says, بَرَّفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. Rather, Allah raised him to himself, and ever is Allah exalted in might and wise. So we believe Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive in the heavens. And he will come back at the end of time as one of the final signs of the day of judgment. He will kill the false Messiah, the fake Messiah, the imposter, and Jesus, there will be peace on earth. Then Allah will claim the lives of the righteous souls. Then the resurrection and the horn will be blown upon the most wicked of people after Jesus and the good people pass away. This is what we believe. Isn't that beautiful? It's beautiful. He's alive. He's the only prophet whom Allah did not claim his soul yet. He remains to be alive. This is the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning Jesus. So Allah raised him up to himself. Ajib. Logical evidence. My favorite story, which I came up with by the grace of Allah, the bank. Maybe some of you heard it before, maybe some of you haven't. But let me tell it to you briefly. There was a bank and a bank owner and an employee at the bank who was the son of the bank owner. There's a bank, there's the one in charge of the bank has his son as an employee in the bank along with another 30 employees, tellers and people who are in charge of different tasks. Okay? Now, this bank owner has a close friend. This friend of his has the tendency to borrow money without paying back. Can you give me, you know, a couple of thousand riyals? I'll give it to you next week. Two years pass by, you don't see the fulus again. This is his habit. Anyways, this man had accumulated so much debt from the owner of the bank that the bank owner decided not to lend him money anymore. Said, khalas, I've learned my lesson. I know I will never see this money. When the guy called him, let's say we're gonna call him X-Man. X-Man called the bank owner and said, listen, I need some money back. He told them, you know what, man? I'm sorry, but I can't do it anymore. I will not lend you any money. You've never paid me back. So he says, come on, you can't do this to me now. He says, I'm sorry, my friend. I can't do it anymore. I've learned my lesson. He says, yeah? Well, I'm going to go to the bank, your bank, and apply for a loan. And you don't have a right to refuse a loan. You have to give me a loan. This is a bank. This is an institute. This is its own separate business. So I'm going to go there. You stop me. Bye. He hangs up the phone. What does the bank owner do? Quickly, he's at the bank. He calls the employees to the conference room. You know, mandatory meeting. Say, listen, Fulan, his name is X, has requested some money from me. I refused. Such and such and such happened. He will be coming here today or tomorrow. I don't know when to borrow some money, to ask for a loan. Do not give him a loan. Do you all understand? Everybody, not you, I know you understand. He's speaking to the employees. No problem, we understand. His son is, by the way, the best employee. He's the most punctual, the most trustworthy. He is the most consistent in production. I mean, he's the ideal employee. His son is the best one. At the end of the day, it's his father's bank. That's what you expect. All of them agree, including his son, that they will not give him a loan. Sure enough, a few hours later, X-Man comes into the bank. He goes to the teller, or you know, the person in charge of this giving loans. He says, such and such and such. He says, listen, I have received information, you know, that I should not give you a loan. The man starts crying. My mother is in the hospital. She's dying. I don't have insurance. If you don't give me this money, we will all be destroyed. He starts, you know, giving him this emotional trip and this guilt trip. Suddenly, the teller started losing, you know, his mother had died before in the hospital because they didn't have any money. So now he feels with this guy. And, you know, he goes to the back and says, listen, guys, it's on me. This guy, you know, promised me he will give me the money. Okay, we will lend him the money. Don't tell anyone. And, you know, they make an agreement. They conspire with each other to lend this guy the money, even though they were told not to do it. Now, who's there? The son. The son says, I object. I will not get involved. They said, listen, we will kill you. If you say something, we will kill you. You don't want to get involved, that's your business, but don't say a word. Don't say a word. He's afraid for his life. He remains quiet. The guy gets the money. As soon as he gets out of the bank, he calls the guy, say, I got the money, man. So what do you mean you got the money? Right here in my pocket, 5,000 riyals. So the boss, the owner of the bank, he goes crazy. He calls him for another mandatory meeting. Say, what happened? What did you guys do? Well, you know, they start, you know, giving him this nonsense. He says, you gave him 5,000 riyals? Says, yes. His son's name is Y. Y, come here. Y comes. Bah! How much is your salary? 5,000 riyals. You will not get your salary this month. We will get this. We will make up for this loan from your own salary. Then he spits on him. Then he says, you are fired. You worthless creature. How could you do this to me? Out, out. And he throws his shoe at him while he's leaving the door. Then he turns around to the employee and says, this is my expression of love to you. I love you. You have sinned. I know my son is innocent. I know my son is innocent because he declared his innocence. But because you are such evil people, the only way I can forgive your sins is by kicking out and firing and taking the money from my own son. This is justice. Thank you very much. In fact, all of you will get a raise. All of you are promoted. And you will have, you know, guaranteed satisfaction as long as you work in this bank. Does that make any sense to you?
No.
That's what they're saying happened with Allah and Jesus. This is the idea. If we are refusing this worldly, in this worldly example, then how do we accept that Allah created Adam and Eve? They disobeyed God. They continued to sin and sin and sin. The sin multiplied and multiplied and multiplied until it became so huge that the only way the sin can be forgiven by God creating, or not even creating, begetting, hasha lillah, his own son, getting him spat on, humiliated, crucified and killed for everyone else who simply accepts him as Lord and Savior to be saved. This is like that. This is like that. If you don't accept this worldly example, then we need to think twice about what we're saying about how God gave us a way out, how this redemption is acquired. This is a very dangerous belief system. We refuse as Muslims to say that. We refuse that God will punish someone who is beloved to Him so you and I can have a good time. We refuse. We have been taught that each soul is responsible for what it earns. This is the biblical, Islamic, and the logical teaching. I'm sure, inshallah, many of you are convinced. Trinity. Belief that there are three persons in one Godhead. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that they are co-equal, co-eternal, one in essence, nature, power, action, and will. This is very, very important. Now, pay attention here. What is being said that the gods, we will deal with the development of the Trinity later on, but just to give you a brief, the one God is actually three in one. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three together, they formulate one single God. Now, we will see, does the Bible support that doctrine? Does Islam support that? And does logic support that? It will be very clear to you, according to the Bible, Jesus saying, "You have heard me say to you, I'm going away and coming back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I." Now, just to so you will know, what is the term father here? It does not mean a biological father. Needless to say, the father is a metaphorical figure of speech. For example, someone who is a little older than me, like the Sheikh over here, if he wants to speak to me, he may say, "My son, can you hand me a tissue?" And I may speak to him, address him in a fashion where we don't mean the literal meaning of the word. Now, why was the term father used in the Bible? First, because the language was Aramaic, Hebrew Aramaic, which was then made into Greek, then translated to different languages. In the Hebrew language, the connotation of Rabb, of Ab, is like Rabb in Arabic. The master, the provider, the sustainer. Because the role of the father is the one who takes care of his wife and children. So it is not intended, as people will say, and you will see evidences for that. But look at this important statement of Jesus. We are being told they are co-equal. Co-equal, meaning God equals Jesus. But Jesus says that God is greater than I. You know, greater sign? Now, as a Muslim, or as someone who loves Jesus, anyone, who are we supposed to believe? Who are we supposed to follow? Isn't it the statement of Jesus that it should be more beloved to us than what is said about him? Ultimately, this was in John chapter 14, verse 28. He said, now we will refute the idea of will, that they have equal will. Jesus said, "I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me." Now they said that they have equal will, but Jesus said, "I of myself can do nothing. As I hear, I judge." You bring an argument to me, I hear it, I will judge. I don't have knowledge of the unseen. I don't know the hidden. I don't know the unseen. What you give to me, what you present to me, I will judge. However, I'm not a wicked man. My judgment is righteous. I will say that which is true and correct. Why? Because I'm trying to establish the law of Allah on earth. I'm not seeking my own will, but the will of He who sent me, or the Father who sent me. Unbelievable. Unbelievable clarity in the statements of Jesus. He said about the day of judgment, "But of that day and hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." How can a God not know the day of judgment? How can Jesus be co-equal with God, part of the triune Godhead, and not know the day of judgment? But that is consistent with the fact that we believe no one knows the day of judgment but Allah Azza wa Jal. Not even the malaika, not even the angels, not even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one knows the day of judgment but Allah. Consistency. Subhanallah, consistency in the teachings. Now there's an argument which may be presented by our fellow Christians. They say there's a statement in the Bible which says, "I and my Father are one." Have you heard this before?
No.
Okay, let me give you the explanation for this one. You must know the context. Whenever you read something, you must know what verses preceded it and what verses will follow it, because they will have something to do with the general meaning. In Islam, we can give the same example. Can you read فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ and stop? No. فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَهُونَ. If you read it on its own, woe to those who pray. But in fact, it's about those who are negligent about prayer. So the context is important. Now, let me give you the context of this one. It's in John chapter 10, verse 30. Jesus was speaking about his ability to keep the sheep, the believers which Allah gave him. He said that he will strive to keep the sheep, the believers which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. Then he said that no one will be able to pluck him out pluck them out of his hand. And no one will be able to pluck them out of the hand of Allah, of the Father. I and my Father are one in purpose. The same way I strive as a messenger, the messenger, he strives that the people who follow him do not leave Islam. Allah also ensures that the believers don't leave Islam. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضَيَّعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And Allah is never to waste your iman, as it comes in Surah Al-Baqarah. So the same way Allah ensures that you remain in faith, if you strive, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam will strive that you remain in faith, the purpose are one. Can't you see? If my boss sent me to you, and he told me to tell you something, and I conveyed it to you, I say to you, look, you say, no, I don't believe you. Say, look, I and the manager are one. We have the same goal, man, to bring this business up. Our purpose is the same. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. Now you want it, it gets better. Look at the further explanation. This is a logical explanation. Look at the ayah, the verse in the Bible. Jesus said, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they also may be one in us. Now according to this, if we were to understand I and my Father are one, then we were to read may be one in us, meaning now the disciples and everyone are also in God. So now Jesus, God and everyone else are one entity. It cannot be. You see? That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. So then Jesus is not speaking about them being one. They are being one in purpose. The message is the same. The disciples of Jesus, Jesus himself, and the creator of Jesus and the disciples, all of them have one objective: the maintenance of the belief of those who follow the prophets and the messengers. Okay. Logical evidence. This, by the way, this argument, the only one which is not of mine, is from a Christian himself, Arius, the Egyptian from Alexandria. He said, if Jesus was in reality the begotten Son of God, then it followed that the Father must have existed before him, the Son. Can the Son come before the Father? It's always the Father who gives birth to the Son. Therefore, there must have been time where the Son, Jesus, did not exist, because the Father must come before the Son. Since God is in essence eternal and ever existing, Jesus could not be of the same essence of God, because the Son must come after the Father. The Father is eternal, ever living. So how can the Son, who had to come later on, be eternal, ever living if he had to come? Logically, it doesn't make any sense. Now this caused a lot of fitna, by the way, in the 4th century among the Christians. Arius brought this idea and it caused a lot of havoc among the people, because he was presenting ideas which were not very welcome, because already Trinity or the Trinitarian belief had already been widely spread among the Christians. Let me give you a brief history of the Trinity. First, let me quote some biblical verses from the Old Testament. For thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, who is God, who formed the earth and made it, who has established it, who did not create it in vain, who formed it to be inhabited, I am the Lord and there is no other. This is how it began, with La ilaha illallah, in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 18. So first, there was one God, the Creator, alone, without any partners. Okay? But things didn't remain the same for a long time. Another ayah which supports this is, but now, thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. Subhanallah. No God came before the Creator, no one will come after him, there's no Savior but him. Clear. But that didn't last. In the between 150 and 318 after Christ, the Greek philosophy, particularly also the Babylonian philosophy, was introduced. As a result, arguments and discussions concerning these new philosophies on the nature of the Son Jesus in relationship to the Father sprouted. And the year 325 in the Council of Nicaea resulted in the first uniform Christian doctrine called the Nicene Creed. The council declared that the Father and Son are of the same substance and co-eternal. So in the year 325 years after Jesus, Now the idea of including Jesus with God started sprouting and having some popularity. 325 years after Jesus, meaning his disciples were Muslims, muwahidun. And those who followed earlier, they were muwahidun until this was introduced later on. It doesn't stop there though. It continues to develop. In the year 381, the Council of Constantinople and the Council of Nicaea had not clarified the divinity of the Holy Spirit. They forgot about him, the third person of the Trinity. So at the end of the 4th century, the Byzantine Emperor Theodosius issued a decree that the doctrine of the Trinity was to be the official state religion and that all subjects shall adhere to it. And anyone who didn't were persecuted and killed. Those who did not like this, they were persecuted and exiled or killed. And one of the people involved in that was Saul himself, who later became Paul and wind up making major changes. Anyways, there's a difference of opinion about what role he played in Christianity among the Christians. I will not elaborate on that. But I want you to look on the side here. First it was one God, then it was two in one, then it became three in one. That's the development. But Jesus did not approve that. He did not teach that. He did not speak of that. Now listen to this piece of information. In the new Encyclopedia Britannica, not Abu Mus'ab's dictionary, it says, neither the word Trinity nor the explicit doctrine as such appears in the New Testament. Nor did Jesus and his followers intend to contradict the Shama. The Shama has to do with Sama, which is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The doctrine developed gradually over several centuries and through many controversies. By the end of the 4th century, the doctrine of the Trinity took substantially the form it has maintained ever since. This is the Bible. This is the Encyclopedia Britannica. Not from me. They are telling you that the word Trinity doesn't exist. Actually, ironically, the word Christianity doesn't exist in the Bible. The word Bible doesn't exist in the Bible. And the word Trinity does not exist in the Bible. Whereas in Islam, the word Islam exists in the Quran, the word Quran exists in the Quran, and the Tawheed, worshipping Allah alone, exists in the Quran. Subhanallah al-Azim. There's a reminder for those. Now, furthermore, if in case you don't like British people, you prefer American, here comes the Encyclopedia Americana. It says Christianity derived from Judaism, and Judaism was strictly Unitarian, meaning one God. Believing that God is one person. 4th century Trinitarianism did not reflect accurately early Christian teaching regarding the nature of God. It was, on the contrary, a deviation from this teaching. Again, historically, this is being supported. Now, what is the true nature of Jesus? You may be asking, what is Jesus? Biblical evidences. So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. This is Matthew chapter 21 verse 11. And he said to them, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed in word before God and all the people. John chapter 6 verse 14. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, this is truly the prophet who is to come into the world. Luke 13:33, Jesus said, nevertheless, I must journey today, tomorrow, and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish outside of Jerusalem. Now he's speaking about himself. He called himself a prophet. This was the nature of Jesus. This is what we believe in Islam. Ya أهل الكتاب, لا تغلوا في دينكم ولا تقولوا على الله إلا الحق. إنما المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه فآمنوا بالله ورسله ولا تقولوا ثلاثة انتهوا خيرا لكم إنما الله إله واحد سبحانه أن يكون له ولد له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وكفى بالله وكيلا. O people of the scripture, Jews and the Christians, do not commit excess in your religion or say about Allah except the truth. The Messiah Jesus, the son of Mary, was but a messenger of Allah, and his word which he directed to Mary, be, and he was, and a soul created at a command from him. So believe in Allah and his messengers. And do not say three, don't say the Trinity. Desist, it is better for you. Indeed, Allah is but one God. This is advice from Allah to his creation. This is Allah advising his own creation. better advice than mine or anyone else's. If people don't listen to Allah, who would they listen to? If Allah tells them, don't say three, there's only one God, and they don't want to listen, then will they listen to us? No, they will never listen. But every human being should bring this to mind. You're speaking about Allah's telling you something. If you ignore Allah today, what will you do on the Day of Judgment when you stand before Him? It will be a big, big issue. So we are able to resolve it today. Let us do so. Exalted is He above having a son. Allah said that the heavens are about to split asunder, and the mountains are about to fall in ruin, and the earth is about to split open, because people said that Allah has begotten a son. And it is not befitting that Allah will beget a son. To Him belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth, and sufficient is Allah as disposer of affairs. The message of Moses, Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. The message of Jesus, He said, do not think that I came to abolish, to destroy the law or the prophets, the law of Moses, the Ten Commandments. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not even the stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. It's unbelievable. Jesus says, I did not come to change anything, and people say, no, He changed everything that was there before. He says, I came to keep everything the same, not even the stroke of a pen, not even the stroke of a pen, not even a fatha, not even a vowel shall be changed from the law, from the Ten Commandments, the first of which is the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And people insist on ignoring Jesus and say, no, He came and He nailed the law on the cross. He didn't eat swine, people eat swine. He was circumcised, Paul said, you don't have to get circumcised, it's the circumcision of the heart. Jesus wasn't circumcised in the heart. The changes were made. He says something, people say something else. But we love Him too much as the messenger of Allah, after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We love Him too much to allow people to say something about Him which He did not conform or did He not agree with, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments, if you break one of the commandments and teaches men so, shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. You must keep the commandments. For I say to you, that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. If you're not better than the rest of the people, if you're not more righteous than the Jews, then you will not enter paradise. What is righteousness? Imanun wa amalun salihun. Belief and righteous deeds. Fasting Ramadan, praying five times a day, doing Hajj, remembering Allah, reciting the Quran. These are the good deeds. Jesus said, if you don't have this righteousness, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Subhanallah al-Azim. Jesus answered him, the first of all commandment, the same thing Moses said. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. But He added something. He added something. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. This is in addition to what Moses had said. And this is consistent with the Quran. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And among mankind are those who take besides Allah, equals, rivals, whom they love the same way they love Allah. Allah said, but those who believe love Allah far more. And you should love the Lord your God in this particular fashion, as Jesus had taught as well. Now behold, a man came and said to Him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? Jesus didn't say, I am good, I'm the Son of God, I am all good, I am co-equal with God. He says, why do you call me good? Right. He said, none is good but one that is God. Why do you call me good? No one is good but one that is God. Jesus in this verse denied divinity. Denied being equal with God. He didn't even like being called good. Why do you call me good? Be careful of exaggerating. Be careful of me and exalting me above the level which Allah gave me. None is good but one that is God. How do you get salvation? How do you get eternal life? But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He didn't say, accept me as your Lord and Savior. He said, keep the commandments. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me. For I have not yet ascended to my Father, But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. This verse explains what is intended by Father, which I was giving you earlier. He himself explained, my Father and your Father, my God and your God. Jesus saying, my God. How can he be God? How can he be equal with God and call upon God? It doesn't make any sense. إِنَّ اللَّهَ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُوهُ هَذَا صِرَاطٌ مُسْتَقِيمٌ. Verily Allah is my Lord and yours, so worship him. This is the straight path. Okay. Not everyone who says to me, Jesus said, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, on the day of judgment, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name, Jesus will say, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness, you who don't keep the commandments. I don't know you. You didn't take out demons in my name, you didn't do exorcism in my name, and you didn't heal anything in my name. I don't know you. So whoever does the will of Allah, which is Islam, submitting to Allah Azza wa Jal. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks as such as these to worship him. This is Allah Azza wa Jal, and we are the manifestation of this verse. We are the ones who are actually worshipping Allah as he deserves to be worshipped. Not really. We can't make it. But the fact that he's the only one deserving of worship, we are the only ones doing it. But Allah deserves much greater than what we are giving. We ask Allah to pardon us for our shortcomings. I will go strictly to the English. And beware of the day when Allah will say, this is in the Quran, O Jesus, son of Mary, did you say to the people, take me and my mother as deities besides Allah? He will say, exalted are you. It was not for me to say that to which I have no right. If I had said it, you would have known it. You know what is in within myself, what is within myself, and I do not know what is within yourself. Indeed, it is you who is knower of the unseen. It's not my right to say to the people to worship me and my mother as gods besides Allah. I said not to them except what you commanded me, to worship Allah my Lord and your Lord. And when I was a witness over them, as long as I was among them. But when you took me up, you were the observer over them, and you are over all things witness. Misconceptions. The first verse you may hear is, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The famous John 3:16. But we have a comment to say. The Revised Standard Version of the Bible is the work of 32 biblical Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating Christian denominations. They produced the Revised Standard Version of the Bible in an effort to correct the many and serious errors that they had found in the King James Bible. The Greek term for begotten in ancient Greek is gienao. Okay, the term used in Greek is gienao, for begotten. But in fact, the word which you find there is monogenes and not gienao, which means unique. Consequently, in the Revised Standard Version, the word that is there is unique and not begotten. Unique and not begotten. And Jesus is unique. Did he have a father? No. Did he do miracles? Yes, he is the unique creation of Allah. So the Greek then does not have the word begotten. And this is the one that they use to prove their point. But their own Christian scholars, after making the necessary studies, declared that this particular term is not from the authentic teachings of Jesus. And it was consequently taken out from the Revised Standard Version. The second misconception. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. Another famous one. Here's the news for you. Now check it out. This verse is now universally recognized as being a later insertion of the church and all recent versions of the Bible, such as the Revised Standard Version, the New Revised Standard Version, the New American Standard Bible, and the New English Bible, the Phillips Modern Bible. All of them do not have this verse. You buy any of them, you open any of them, you will find that this was taken out. It was a footnote which one of the scribes had written, and it found its way and it crept into the actual text. But when they made the necessary studies, they realized this is not from the Greek manuscripts. It doesn't exist in any Greek manuscript, so they threw it out of the Bible. So this is the only verse which they have to support Trinity. It has been taken out from the Bible. Subhanallah, even in their own book, Allah had made the signs clear. Even among their own scholars, Allah had made the signs clear. That anything that they try to fabricate will not go for a long way. Okay, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So they say then, you know, that must make Jesus, you know, one with God. But we say, there's nothing wrong with this statement. Jesus is the way, not the destination. Jesus is the way, not the destination. What is the destination? God. Jesus is the way. Wasn't the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way? Wasn't Noah the way? Wasn't Abraham the way? The Moses, every prophet during his time, he was the way. Jesus during his time is the way. He is the truth. Yes, every prophet of Allah is the truth. He cannot be a liar. He cannot be a fabricator. He cannot be a forger. Otherwise, people will not accept him. Is he the life? Yes, he gave life. In the Quran, Allah said about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, istajibu lillahi wa lirrasuli idha da'akum lima yuhyikum." O you who have believed, respond to Allah and His Messenger if He calls you to that which will give you life. So Allah told us in the Quran that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives you life. During the time of Jesus, He gave life. Which life? Spiritual life. The life of belief. The life of salvation. Which is believing in the oneness of God. You can't go through Allah during His time by disbelieving in Him like the Jews. You can't go to Him through atheism. You must go through Him to God through Jesus during His time by believing Him and believing in Him as the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. He said, He who has seen me has seen the Father. This is another misconception. Let me give you the context. Philip, one of the disciples of Jesus, he said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? When you see the miracle of God, doesn't that make you believe in God? When you see the manifestation of the creation of God, doesn't that make you believe in God? It doesn't mean that you are seeing God physically, because we will see in the refutation as it comes in John chapter 1 verse 18, no one has seen God at any time. In the Bible it says no one has seen God at any time. So how would we reconcile between them then? Seeing Jesus, meaning you've seen the miracles, you've seen me give life to the dead, you still doubt? You have to see the Father? You have to see God with your own eyes to believe? Am I not proof? Am I not evidence enough? This is the intent. And anyways, if somebody wants to look at it from another angle, we say this is contradiction then. And you must look at this verse and the light of other biblical verses as well. Jesus' mission was not complete. It was not complete. Look what he said. He says, but now I go away to him who sent me, to Allah. And none of you ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper, in other translations, the Counselor, in other translations, the Comforter, will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. Who is this? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is John 16:5-7. And he said, Jesus, and when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. The salvation will become available. It is available today. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, Islam. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And when you begin the Quran, when you recite, what do you say? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He does not speak of his own desire. It is only revelation being revealed to him. And Jesus said he will not speak of his own authority. It will be the truth he hears from Jibreel alayhi salatu salam, which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me. The only one who honored Jesus is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Jews, they belied him. They disbelieved in him. We are the ones who honor Jesus, who believe in him, who love him. For he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Subhanallah. Unbelievable prophecy. Allah said and mentioned when Jesus, the son of Mary, said, O children of Israel, indeed I am the messenger of Allah to you, confirming what came before me of the Torah and bringing good tidings of a messenger to come after me, whose name is Ahmad. This is one of the names of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says, this day I have perfected for you your religion and completed my favor upon you and have approved for you Islam as religion. Say, the truth has come and falsehood has departed. Indeed, is falsehood ever bound to depart? Subhanallah. And finally, I say, Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep the commandments. If you have any questions or any other information, then this is how you can contact us. Jazakumullah khairan for your patience. I apologize for taking extra 7 minutes than the allocated time, but I find it necessary to convey the message to you. If anyone has any questions, you may ask. We'll be more than happy to entertain them, inshallah. Okay. Now.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
First of all, I must say thank you very much for your very convincing way. Especially for your logical argument. Whenever we go to Europe or America, sometimes they ask me one question.
Yes.
When you believe in Isa alayhi salam that he is a limb, why you don't believe that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, he is also alive? And same thing from India and Pakistan, some section of Muslim also believe that Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still alive. They call Hayatun Nabi. We call Khatamun Nabi. Same question, European Americans, they are asking me and I don't have the convincing reply. Can you?
Yes, sure. The convincing reply is that Allah Azza wa Jal had given each prophet and messenger something special and distinct to them. Moses split the ocean, Abraham was thrown into the fire without him being burnt, Noah was made to build the ark and you know, he didn't drown, and you know, the list goes on. The specialty of Jesus, peace be upon him, that Allah decreed that he will not die yet. He will come back at the end of time. However, that was not the case with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, Allah says in the Quran, "Innaka mayyitun wa innahum mayyitun." Verily, you will die and they will die. And he died, alayhi salatu wasalam. And they buried him. This life, which some of the Muslims speak about, is a misunderstanding of some textual evidences, wherein the Prophet ﷺ said Allah had made the earth, had made forbidden for the earth to consume the flesh of the prophets. So it doesn't consume their body. It doesn't mean that they're alive. And the other misunderstanding is based on the idea when you send as-salam, when you do durood sharif, when you send salat salam, Allah returns his soul so he may respond to you. But see, the hadith mentions that Allah will return his soul so he may respond. It doesn't say that he's alive waiting for it. Allah had designated some angels, special angels, who convey the salam from us to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who in turn will respond to you. He is not alive in the sense that Jesus is alive in the heaven right now. Okay? Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.